greetings. And now for something a little different. To celebrate the launch of my recently released whiskeyanalysis.com website, I thought I'd interrupt my usual flashlight feed to give you a bit of an overview of single malt style Scotch whiskies. My whiskeyanalysis.com site is a little bit different than my flashlight reviewing. I'm not doing detailed testing of whiskies. Instead, what I'm doing is a meta-analysis of whiskey flavors and whiskey quality by combining information from a large number of expert reviewers, properly normalizing it and integrating it into one giant resource, which we'll see in the whiskey database. What I thought I would do here is just kind of give you an overview of the whiskey flavors as characterized by proper scientific cluster analysis on the site, as you'll see described, and sort of help you work your way through whiskey flavors if you're somewhat new to whiskey, or if you're interested in exploring new flavors within whiskey. In this case, I thought I would start for my kind of inaugural video with an overview of single malt whiskies, which is one of the more popular flavor categories. It's, of course, a very complex field. There's a lot of different types of Scotch-style whiskies out there. And what I've done here in front is pulled out a number of different whiskies to highlight the characteristics of different flavor clusters. So what I'm going to do is just sort of walk you through. If you are interested in exploring whiskies, let's say, in a structured tasting, I'm going to kind of go through the sequence of whiskies you would probably experience just to kind of give you an idea of what the categories are and really, in a sense, what best sequence you probably want to approach them. I'm going to start with an example of what is in the GH cluster. So the clusters are arbitrarily numbered, or rather lettered, from A to J. And it's based on, again, a clustering analysis based on expert descriptors of the whiskey, main components of the whiskey flavor characteristics. And you'll see that all explained on the whiskeyanalysis.com website. But I'm going to start with the light one here in the middle, which is the Dalwhinnie 15-year-old. So a comment right away. So most people historically have looked to kind of characterize malts by their age or where they come from. And this is a good example of why you don't really want to do that normally. You can also see here in the little sub-label, the gentle spirit. What they're trying to get at is this is actually a very light whiskey. And I actually have it here in the 1 liter duty-free size. Usually you get this at a 7 to 750 mil size. The point is that this is actually a very, very light single malt. So despite a Highland style, which typically has peaty flavors in it, which are virtually non-existent in this particular whiskey, although you can detect a faint hint of smoke, potentially, the main flavors are more sort of a honeysuckle type, both aroma on the nose and on the palate when you're tasting it. It is probably the gentlest whiskey that I've tried that is still a quality whiskey. You can certainly get gentle or light whiskies that are not very good. This is an example of one that gets a reasonably high rank in my Metacritic database, and you have a very light flavor profile. So if you're new to whiskey, this is an example of a really good one I recommend you start with. If you want to see a little bit more what the whiskey looks like, get that cork out. We'll just pour a little bit here in a Glencairn whiskey glass. This is a good glass for both tasting and nosing of a whiskey. So you can see, if I hold it up to the light, you can see some of the colors in the whiskey. If you play around with it, you can see sort of legs like you would see in wine. I don't typically recommend you spend a lot of time focusing on the color or the appearance of a whiskey. Most whiskeys have color added to them, a type of caramel. So I wouldn't necessarily worry about that part too much. A glass like this, though, or any kind of tulip-shaped glass is helpful to help concentrate aromas. So you would want to spend a bit of time just nosing the glass, starting with your nose well outside the glass. Most people find whiskey pretty strong, so you'd want to take your time getting your nose close to it. You would eventually sort of stick your nose right into the glass to get a good sniff, but you work your way up to it. I recommend people spend a lot of time nosing the whiskey before they sample it. The most important thing when you sample it is to spend your time there as well. So you don't want to take too much in on your first sip. You want to hold it for as long as you can in your mouth, sort of swish it around a little bit, and really try to avoid making any observations about flavor on your first taste. Even at 40 to 45% alcohol, this is very strong stuff. It is hard to get used to the alcohol burn of whiskey if you're drinking it neat like this, so no water or ice added, which is what I recommend if you want to experience the full wide range of flavors. Try to hold it in your mouth as long as you can. When you swallow and keep it in your mouth, you don't want to burn the back of your throat with it right away. When you do swallow it, I think you'll find in your second sip is when that, once you sort of cleansed your palate with the alcohol burn, you'll begin to start pulling out different flavors. And you'll find the flavors kind of come in sequence. This is a fairly gentle, again, whiskey. It's not very complex. There are not that many flavors, but they do come in sort of a defined sequence as you're tasting it. And you'll find there's a very lingering finish as well with whiskeys that will last for several minutes after you're done with the glass. So it's interesting to sort of take your time and explore these different flavors and see how they go for you. This is a really good one to start with, again, because it's relatively light and relatively pleasant flavors and aromas. As I explained on the whiskeyanalysis.com site, I then recommend you go up to more flavorful whiskeys. And I specifically recommend you start by going towards the more winey end of the spectrum as to the smoky end of the spectrum. We'll do those later. Next one up, one that I've had a lot of success with, is the Auchentoshan 12-year-old. So as you can see there on the label, this is a triple distilled whiskey, unlike most Scotch whiskey, which is only double distilled. This is from a Lowland distillery. There aren't that many Lowland distilleries in operation anymore. This is certainly a popular one. Colorant has definitely been added to it because it would actually be a lot lighter than this, I think, in its native form. Auchentoshan is not as highly regarded by critics compared to most other whiskeys. I find the reason for that is likely because of its lighter taste overall. Most whiskey experts have sort of migrated to really strong flavors. They tend not to give very high scores to more delicate whiskies. I particularly like the Auchentoshan. I find it goes over very well with newcomers to whiskey in general, and Scotch in particular. It has a more caramel flavor, as I would, so I'd say the dominant note. It's also reasonably dry. You definitely get sort of a bit of maltiness, but you get the kind of oak coming through in the wood as well. And it's not as sweet as the caramel might sort of imply. I've had a lot of success with this one for introducing newcomers to Scotch. Most people who have tried this really like it. So this is a really good bottle. It doesn't get the highest rank, but for the next sort of EF flavor clusters up, you get a little more flavor. You're getting closer to the winier flavors without getting too strong yet. I think this is a really good choice, despite its somewhat mediocre score on the whiskey critics. One that gets a very high score in this category, again, on the EF category, is Redbreast. Now, Redbreast is not actually a Scotch whiskey. As you can see here, it's an Irish whiskey, single pot still whiskey, which is the traditional Irish method, which is not the way it's usually done these days in most cases. This is actually a blend, if you like, of a single malt type compilation and the more grain style, but all done in a single pot still. So this gets back to whether or not your barley is malted. Again, I go through all the explanation of what constitutes a single malt on the website. You might be a little surprised to hear that it is not a single cask, as most people assume, but is in fact a blend of different malt style whiskies, all from the same distillery. The Irish have a different tradition in this regard, and so this is using a pot still, which is a common mechanism by which you make whiskey for Scotch style whiskies, but they combine in the mash bill both malted barley and unmalted barley. So that's something that's a little different. You don't have to worry too much about the distinction, but the one thing I'd say about most Irish whiskies, and the Redbreast in particular, done in this style, is it tends to have a bit more of an oily characteristic, which may or may not be your interest. One thing about the Redbreast 12-year is it's a very nice whiskey. It has a very rich set of flavors for the EF category, and I think this is one, again, it gets a very high critic score. If you're not used to whiskeys, though, you might find it a bit more overwhelming compared to something like the Auchentoshan. But it's definitely one you want to migrate up to and give a try to. There's a few other Redbreasts out there, the 15-year, and there's a cask strength. But again, you want to sort of work your way up to that based on your experience, starting with something like the Redbreast 12. As we move up into the super cluster ABC, which is the really heavy sherry bombs, as they're known. I have an example here, but I want to start by pulling in an extra one just to get you warmed up a little bit. This is the Ben Ryack single malt, 12-year-old. Specifically, it's the matured and sherry wood version. You can see they're up at the top. So this, here's me, you can see the whole label again. So Ben Ryack's been around for a little while. This is a very affordable single malt. You can find it in many places, relatively inexpensively priced. I like it as kind of a good introduction to a sherried malt. The reason for that is it is not overwhelmingly strong. For those of you who have had sherry, you know it's a very sort of fortified alcohol drink, very rich in flavor, very sweet. Using sherry wood basically allows you to introduce a small amount of sherry that's trapped in the wood into your final single malt product as it ages in the barrel. This will introduce some sherry notes and flavors. You'll detect some sweetness, you'll detect dark fruits, you might detect chocolate, you'll detect a variety of things that come from the sherry. And again, for newcomers to Scotch, that can be overwhelming. I find the Ben Ryuk 12 here is actually a good introduction because it is not as strong as many sherry bombs. And I think the reason for that is the base spirit is a more gentle type distillate that goes into the barrels. So you don't have as many strong flavors as you do on some other sherry bombs in that ABC category. Another one though you might want to consider, I'll just put it here side by side, is the Glendronach 12-year-old. And you can probably even tell from the labels there's a similarity here. Glendronach is actually owned by Ben Ryuk, at least nowadays. Whiskey distillers change hands quite a bit. The Glendronach 12 is a very different whiskey. It's in the same category as the Ben Ryuk. It's a heavily sherried whiskey, but it's a much stronger whiskey. And by that I mean it has much stronger flavors. It's a very interesting whiskey. It's also a very good buy. It's about the same price as the Ben Ryuk 12. But in practice, so one thing about Glendronach, the distillery was shut down for several years, and so although this bottle says it's been aged, 12 years, as I explained on the site, an age statement on a whiskey is simply the minimum age of the youngest whiskey that went into the vatting. So they don't like to use the word blending when it comes to single malts, but they are indeed mixing together a large number of individual barrels or casks of malt whiskey. So when you see an age like 12, all that means is the youngest thing in there is guaranteed to be at least 12. It could be older, however. If you research online, and I have an article on this as well, you'll see the Glendronach 12. Because it was shut down for a number of years, this particular bottling, which is from February 2014, everything in this bottle must by definition be at least 17 years old. The reason for that is there are rules about how you can name things, and you cannot claim a whiskey that you did not manufacture. And because of their shutdown period, there was nothing in this bottle that could be any younger than 17 years. Now, don't get fooled by high age statements, they're really just an indicator of expense and cost. They do change the flavor somewhat, but most people comment this seems awfully mature or complex for a 12-year-old, and the reason for that is it's actually quite a bit older. Now, Glendronach is at the point where some of the new make can be working its way into the new bottles, but of course they are going to make an effort to try to keep consistency as much as they can. Again, keep in mind that there's no absolute way to ensure consistency. There's a general recipe that distillers will use when blending, or I should say vatting, because they don't like the word blending. When vatting together different individual malt whiskies, it's going to be hard, however, to maintain complete consistency over time. Part of the reason why my review site focuses on whiskies from the last couple of years, you can't really trust that something from 10, 15 years ago is going to taste the same due to the process by how they try to maintain quality control. And I discuss all that in more detail on the whiskeyanalysis.com site. Anyway, the Glendronach is a good one to try. It's not really something for newcomers, though. I think it might be put off by the strong flavors and the complexity of the whiskey. So what I'm going to move on to instead, what I have here at the far left, is what I kind of consider one of the ultimate type sherry bombs. So this is the Aberlour, in this case the Aberlour Abunar. We do get down to, they use a lot of Gaelic names for Scottish whiskey, so these can be sometimes hard to pronounce. This is a batch style whiskey. So this is batch or cask, I think what do they call it here, lot number 49. Again, the point is that's not an individual barrel. That is still a compilation of many barrels of whiskey, but they do them in batches. And each batch is going to be a little different than the one before. That's why they don't give an age statement, they give a batch number. 49 is, in my view, a good one. You'll see a lot of commentary about individual batches or lots online. 49 tends to be fairly popular. You might still be able to find it in the stores, although a lot of places are carrying batch 50 right now. This is a real sherry bomb to me. The other point I should mention as well is it's actually done at a higher strength. So you can see there the 60.1%, unlike the low 40% range of most whiskies in terms of absolute volume. This makes it a lot stronger. You are definitely likely to want to dilute this with a bit of water. I don't know too many people who would like to drink a 60% cask strength whiskey. Diluting it will definitely help bring out the flavors and tame the burn. I find this a really nice example of a really strong classic sherry bomb. Your preferences might be a little bit different here, but it's a very popular one. In fact, the whole Aberlour line is something that goes over well with people. The 12-year-old non-chill filtered, in particular, is a favorite. But there's other ones out there as well, and you'll see how they all rank on the whiskeyanalysis.com site. Now that takes you up to the really strong winey flavors. And then that's the way I recommend you go, from the light flavors to the strong winey flavors with very little smoke. Now what most people associate with Scotch whiskey is a high level of peat or peat smoke. So this gets back to the manufacturing process for whiskey and how people malted the whiskey. You don't have to do this today. In fact, there's various ways you can do this. You will find there are certain distilleries, though, who really emphasize the peat nature of the whiskey. That's actually something that's really been emphasized in the last few years. Historically, the peat was not as emphasized in some of these whiskeys as they are today. I'm not as big of a fan, so I'm only going to give you two examples here. But as you go up, some of them can be quite nice. So as you go up, now on the other side of the flavor chart that you'll see on the whiskey site, you go into category I, which are the ones that have a light to moderate level of smoke. I'm going to pick one here that's a favorite of mine, which is the Highland Park 12-year-old. So Highland Park is a little different. This is from Orkney Islands. It's a little unusual. Most whiskies in this category are Highland whiskies, which tend to use peat. Highland Park is a popular one. The 12-year-old is a good kind of trade-off for cost, for value. One of the things that's interesting about, I think, this one is you get a bit of a sherry influence still coming in here, although it's not as strong as some others. But it's a very nice whiskey. It's a nice way to bring in a bit of smoke while still having other flavors. I think a classic for me is the Highland Park 18. That's a much more expensive whiskey, about three times the price of the 12-year-old where I live. That's also an unusual one in that it's somewhat in between the smoky, winey categories while being very complex. So Highland Park kind of fits in a somewhat unique niche. There are certainly other things you can try in the category I that you might find interesting. The Talisker 10-year is a very nice kind of traditional Highland-style smoky, peaty one. Ardmore Traditional Cask is one I think is quite decent. The Bowmores are very common. So there's a lot of options here you can try. I'm also a big fan of the Oban 14, though that's not quite as popular as some other reviewers, because it has, I think, because it's not actually smoky enough, but again, there's various reasons why people like different things. But I really don't think you can go too wrong with the Highland Park as well for a very distinctive style. As you go up to even more smoky type flavors, these come a couple of different ways. You get your Lefroigs and your Ardbegs. Especially the younger ones tend to have a lot of peat smoke without a lot of other flavors. Something like the Lefroig Quarter Cask is a phenomenal deal. It's available relatively inexpensively here in Canada. I'm not as crazy about those whiskies because I find, if I'm going to get a lot of smoke in the whiskey, I like to have other flavors in there as well. That's why, for me, one of my favorites in the heavily smoky category is the Lagavulin 16. So you can see the label here. For many people, this is something of a, I guess you could call it the holy grail of whiskies. There are a lot of people I know who feel that this was the whiskey that really got them going down the whiskey path, or the single malt path. They find it very distinctive, very strong, very flavorful. There's a lot to it. All certainly true. I wouldn't recommend, although again, a lot of people will point to this one as one that really got them down their Scotch whiskey journey. It isn't necessarily one you want to start with, because you're going to find it very overwhelming to sort of leapfrog right to the end of a rich, complex set of flavors combined with smoke. Now, once you develop a taste for whiskeys, I do recommend you start migrating to this category and specifically try the Lagavulin 16 or the 12-year Distiller's Edition, although I prefer the 16. Again, one thing about this one, though, it is very strong. The flavors do linger. You will basically smell like an ashtray for the rest of the evening while drinking this one, so your significant other might prefer you to be in another room. It's one I recommend you give a try to, but you might want to save it for sort of your last whiskey of the evening, just to give a sample to. It is, again, very strong and potentially overwhelming for newcomers. So that's just kind of a brief introduction to single malt whiskies, the major sort of flavor styles and how I recommend you move through them. I might do a few additional videos in the future showcasing other styles, for example, Japanese or Taiwanese whiskies, which are quite interesting as well and very, very single malt in style. There's, of course, a very large world of bourbon-type whiskies. And there are, of course, Canadian whiskies, and I think maybe I'll profile Canadian whiskies at some point as well. It's a somewhat underappreciated category, and I think it's good to spend a little bit of time on them as well. There's some interesting examples available, largely only in Canada. We don't export as much of the higher-end stuff, but I think I'll probably get around to that one of these days as well. But this is just really just sort of an inaugural video to introduce the concepts that you'll see on whiskeyanalysis.com and the detailed whiskey ratings from a variety of expert reviewers, all properly normalized and integrated through statistical methods, which are all described on the site. After this, I'm going to get back to my flashlight reviews, of course. So I just thought I'd introduce this one and insert it into the mix. Not to worry, I will be getting back to my usual type of reviews very shortly. But I hope you enjoy this particular introduction and you get a chance to check out the whiskeyanalysis.com site. Thanks for your time.